This is the Thriller Dome in Atlanta, where the high-flying Tar Heels of North Carolina will pay a visit to Georgia Tech. In the glow of the aftermath in a battle fought to determine national supremacy Thursday against top-ranked Duke, North Carolina proved, at least for now, they're number one. Antoine Jamison showed why he's the top candidate for the Naismith Award. And when Jamison wasn't dissecting the usually tight Blue Devil defense, junior Vince Carter was finding his mark inside. Thursday's thriller is over, so today against Georgia Tech, they'll have to fight off a natural letdown. The Tar Heels' victory Thursday was a confidence builder, but an ACC loss in Atlanta today would surely tarnish that brilliance. A 23-1 record into Georgia Tech. The Jackets are now 14-8. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Mike Patrick. It's great to have you with us. Well, North Carolina certainly made a statement Thursday night against Duke. They beat the Blue Devils 97-73. Just think about that. That's a 24-point win over the number one team in the country. And Antoine Jamison was certainly the key. He lived up to his status as a player of the year favorite. 35 points, 11 boards, as dominating a performance as you will ever see in a big game. And when he wasn't doing it inside, Vince Carter was. They also played some great defense. Okalijah in action there. And Cota with 12 assists. This one to Jamison for another big dunk. Even the freshman center Haywood got into the act with a slam. The numbers on Antoine Jamison, 35, one off of his career high. He did it on 14 out of 20 shooting, that's 70%. He also had 11 rebounds. Coming up, North Carolina coach Bill Guthridge on the big victory, and Jay Billis will have a look at Georgia Tech star Matt Harpering. All that and more, stay with us. North Carolina will face Georgia Tech. The Heels coming off a dominant performance Thursday night against Duke. Jay Billis, who worked that game with us, is with North Carolina head coach Bill Guthridge.
Coach, you had a great win against Duke on Thursday night, and a lot of people have to ask the question, is there going to be a natural letdown, and what can you as a coach and a staff do about that?
Well, Jay, I think there is a tendency for a letdown when you get sky high like we were for Thursday night, and we hope that we're going to be able to come back today and play a good game. If not, we'll be in trouble. And we took Friday off. It was our natural day to take off for the day off during the week. And I think that helped. And we had a good hour practice yesterday and came on down here. But we better be ready, because I think Georgia Tech's a very good team.
Well, today in Georgia Tech, clearly you're facing one of the best players in the conference in Matt Harpering. Give me your assessment of Harpering and what you can do to try to slow him down.
Well, I don't know if we can contain him, but we'll certainly try to. Matt's a wonderful player, such a good passer, such savvy, stays on the move all the time. We'll have Automola Okalaja on him some, Vince Carter on him some. But Matt has really blended in with the rest of the team. Glover's really come into his own, and Jones is blocking shots inside and on down the line. They're just a very good team. They're not just Matt Harpering.
Coach, thanks for your time. Good luck. Mike.
All right, Jay, thanks very much. The Stars will be coming out on a Sunday afternoon here in Atlanta. Some great players on both ball clubs. Ed Cota, the ACC's leading assist man. Carter, the high flyer. Glover, Tech's terrific freshman scorer. Bobby Crimmins has always done well in these big game situations, especially here in Atlanta. Welcome back to the Thriller Dome in Atlanta. Let's take a look at the starting lineups. First, for North Carolina, these guys are the best shooting team in the country. Just remarkable numbers. Shamon Williams has been the perfect outside complement for the Heels, averaging over 15 points a game, shooting better than 40% from behind the arc.
And starting at the other forward, he's a
for Georgia Tech Rookie of the Year candidate Deion Glover, now number 5 in the AC scoring race at 18.1. In his last 3 games, he is averaging 21 points per ball game. We asked Bobby Crimmins what he thought the key to today's game was, and he came up with a rather surprising answer.
Well, I have to say Travis Bybee. The point position is so important to us. Travis last game had 1 turnover, and I thought that was crucial in our win against Clemson. And I think if Travis is relaxes, he's a freshman, TJ Vines will help him, but I think our point position is crucial to taking care of the basketball and running the offense.
Of course, not so surprising when you consider the quality of play in this league. If you don't have good point guard play, you're history.
And there's no question about that, but you also need good inside play. And one thing that Travis Spivey is going to have to do is try to get his inside guys integrated into the ball game. Also, defensively, Spivey has got a Herculean task. He's about 210 pounds, 6'3". He's got the build of a football player, and he's going to have to contend with Ed Cota's dribble all day long. That's going to be a real challenge for him.
Spivey had about a 1.2-to-1 assist-to-turnover ratio. Much better against Clemson. He was 6-1. Here are the standings. Now North Carolina and Duke tied at the top with that 1 loss. Maryland with an impressive win yesterday, coming back from behind at Florida State. They've moved into sole possession of third. Fourth place really up for grabs. And Georgia Tech, this could be a big one today if they could find a way to upset this Goliath, this number 1 Tar Heel club of North Carolina.
And Georgia Tech much better than that 3-6 ACC mark. They've lost 4 of their 6 ACC games that they've lost in the loss column by a total of 13 points. They've been there.
Harpring controls the opening tip off the hand of Jones. Spivey matched up with Cota.
North Carolina starting out in man-to-man. Vince Carter on Harpring. That's going to be a key matchup. Carter has got the athleticism and the strength to stay with Harpring.
Spivey will have to reset everything with 12 seconds on the shot clock.
Another good matchup is Jamison on Maddox.
Glover, a little off balance on the jumper, and he missed it badly. And out of bounds to Georgia Tech. Only 3 on the shot clock as the ball did not hit the rim. They have to be aware of that.
And 3 seconds is plenty of time. Catch, shot fake, and a dribble, and you can get off a good shot.
Maddox will have to take the 3. Got it off in time, but missed. Did not hit the rim. It's a shot clock violation. Ball will go to Carolina. It's not a good sign for Georgia Tech. 2 shots in the opening possession, both air balls.
North Carolina doesn't get near the credit it deserves for the outstanding man-to-man defense that it puts on game after game. And especially when you consider it's only got a 7-man rotation.
And until recently, that was only 6. Shamon Williams against Spivey. This is Cota. 7.7 assists a game for Ed Cota. Number 1 in the conference, number 3 in the country. Mac Tarjai, who hit a 3-pointer against Duke, misses this one.
And Maddox drew the assignment of Jamison.
Maddox, nice dish. Jones wasn't ready for it, then puts it up and missed it. Jones looks a little nervous right now. Cota dumps it off to Jamison. And Jamison goes down. This guy's got to take lessons in how to fall. When he hits the ground, he hits it harder than anybody I've ever seen.
Well, he hits the ground so much because he goes after it so hard, Mike. And what big guy runs the country even close to as well as Antoine Jamison? I can't think of one.
Harpering into the lane. That's going to be a foul on, I believe, Carter. And it will be on Vince Carter.
Antoine Jamison runs the floor like a gazelle. It's amazing how fast he gets down the court. He beats the defense, oftentimes beats the ball. That puts a tremendous amount of pressure on your transition D.
Maddox got it, tied at 2.
Michael Maddox has really improved his game over his first 3 years in a Georgia Tech uniform. And he's done it with consistency. Hard work in the weight room over the summer. He's lost some weight. And he comes to play every night now.
Shamon Williams with the 3, buries it. Shamon
Williams. Georgia Tech switching on some screens. That makes some difficult matchups. Harpering couldn't get out on him for fear he'd go right past him. Good Here's the guy, Travis Spivey. Very strong with the ball, a good penetrator, gets into the lane. But he's got to hit some open shots. He's going to have some opportunities.
Harpring tries to answer with the three. In and out, Jameson with another board. He leads the ACC in rebounding and scoring. Harpring is second in both categories. Give and go, and the ball's kicked down the lane by Cota out of bounds. A rare time when he's receiving a pass.
Nice little pass and cut, but quarters were a little bit close and it went off his foot. And there goes an outstanding player. Shamon Williams is one of those guys who often gets overlooked because of the numbers put up by Jameson and the spectacular plays by Vince Carter, but he's really the glue on this team. 2-3 zone.
Okalaja in for the first time. Here's a steal. They rotate their starters alphabetically. Carter on the run. Whoa!
You could feel that over here. The closest thing in the ACC to a human highlight film, Vince Carter, and intelligently Michael Maddox just got out of the way. There's nothing you can do on that. Hello.
Well, if you don't tackle him at midcourt, you're right. Get out of the way.
You have got to run the court against this team and preferably bump them when you're going down the court. Try to change their path.
7-2 Tar Heels against the zone. Glover too strong. Jones, nice rebound. Had it blocked on the follow off of Maddox, hands out of bounds.
Mike, is this the natural letdown we were talking about before the game?
Yeah, but it's for Georgia Tech.
I'll tell you what, if this is a letdown, I don't want to see them when they're ready to play.
When they are on their game, as they were the other night, it is a thing of beauty to watch unless you happen to be rooting for the other team.
You know, Bobby Kremitz made a great point before the ball game. He said, this team is as much fun to watch as any that I've seen in my years in the league, and he's right.
Okalaja. Jameson tried to keep it alive, but Harpring took it away. Great hustle by Harpring. Spivey, a little shake and bake, can't get inside. Maktar Jai with the foul. The basket will count. Think he got away with one.
He definitely got away with one, but that's Matt Harpring. He does not stop when he gets the ball in there. And one thing that North Carolina's done a good job over the years against Harpring is they don't foul him. See that little hop underneath? That was a walk. But he keeps going after it. He seeks out that contact. This is the eighth time that Matt Harpring has suited up against North Carolina. He's only shot 20 free throws. This will be 21.
You know, Harpering already looks like he's gone five rounds in a championship fight. Here comes pressure by Georgia Tech.
1-2, 1-1. Just trying to slow down that North Carolina freight train. Give him a different look each time down. And Jones isn't even going to go out there and play Jai.
Carter from long range buries the three. 10-5 Carolina.
And one of the things, Mike, I think has been lost in Vince Carter's maturity, he just doesn't do the spectacular. He's got the complete game. Defense, too.
Lazy pass by Maddox. This is Cota. Charge. One on Cota. Nice defense by Spivey. Got a timeout, 15:43 to go in the half. Vince Carter has already lit up the Thriller Dome. We'll be back in a moment. Ten-5, North Carolina with the lead here at the Thriller Dome in Atlanta. Hope you'll join Dave Feldman and Quinn Buckner tonight and every Sunday night this year for College Hoops Tonight. ESPN2's weekly look at the world of college basketball. Information, highlights, a look at the week ahead. College Hoops Tonight, tonight. Vince Carter getting a little breather. When you go up that high, you run out of oxygen, don't you?
And he was just showing Terrence Newby the spot on his arm where he hit the rim and the bruise he's going to have, but I think it's all worth it. North Carolina back to man.
Harpering low to Maddox, backing in. Nice move, Michael Maddox with the left hand.
You know, at 6'9", Michael Maddox can step out and hit the three where he is very proficient. One of the only Yellow Jackets shooting over 40% in ACC play. But he is outstanding in the post. You can see with that little up and under move. Guy can really score down low. That gives Georgia Tech another dimension. He's going against a very good defender in Adamola Okalaja.
Maktar Jai was flexing that left elbow. He's got the wrap on it, apparently in some pain. Georgia Tech in the zone, in the middle of it. Williams got the rebound, feeds underneath to Jameson. He missed it. Jai with a rebound. I don't think I've ever seen Jamison miss his shot in there before. Oh, Kalijah doesn't miss.
Passed by Kalijah.
Harpering hustling it up court. They have a 5-on-4 advantage. Maddox from outside with a miss. Good block out by Kalijah, and here comes Williams. Cota back to Williams. Kept alive by Kalijah.
You know, Carolina didn't score there, but that was a good-looking break. Always under control, Ed Cota.
The zone against Maryland gave them an awful lot of trouble. The Terps, the only team to beat North Carolina.
Got to watch the lob when you're in a 2-3 zone. Carolina likes to get a guy behind it.
Shamon Williams, too strong, rebound to Spivey. Pushes it ahead to Glover. He fires. Whoa, Glover's way off. Harpering to Maddox. Little freshman nerves out there, perhaps, Jay?
Well, especially against North Carolina in the first game in the Smith Center. Deion Glover went 4-for-21 from the field. You know he wants to redeem himself, and he's pressing a little bit right now. You can see it on his face.
Trying to isolate Maddox here. Nice spin to the basket. Goaltending. Oh, they found something here with Maddox. He's been able to operate inside.
And you know where they found it was against Duke. Michael Maddox had to go inside when Alvin Jones got in some foul trouble against the Blue Devils, and he's got some outstanding post move. That's a great spin move around a very quick defender in Antoine Jamison.
6 points for Maddox. It's 12-9. Carolina by 3, 13-41 to go first half.
And Bobby Kremen's going to stay with his 2-3 zone until North Carolina figures out a way to solve it.
Carter tries the three. Maddox with a rebound.
Now, one of the things, Mike, you can't do against the zone is just sit on the outside and shoot over it. You have got to penetrate and find the soft spots in the gaps and put some pressure on the defense.
Inside to Jones, the big guy scores. He's got some nice, smooth offensive moves.
Alvin Jones had his best game of the year against North Carolina in the first game, 18 points and 10 rebounds.
12-11. There's Jamison. Jones trying to push him away from the basket, and he scores. At least in that zone, Jay, you can get some help from the wing a little bit.
And he didn't get it there. Somebody's got to come down and double team to get the ball out of Jamison's hands. He could just pick him apart.
Glover wheels to the hoop. That's going to be another goaltending on Maktar Jai. Sometimes he seems to lose a little bit control of his emotion the way he did the other night when he got the technical.
Well, there's no question that that was goaltending. A great pass and nice job here by Glover making the spin move. That ball was on the way down, and Jai should have just left it alone.
It's a 1-point game. Shamon Williams had it stuffed, and he knocked it out of bounds.
Not successful there, but that's the kind of penetration I'm talking about. You got to get in the gaps of that defense and force it to help and recover, and you're going to get some opportunities. And Alvin Jones showing why he's among the nation's leaders in block shots.
Spivey will get a breather, and T.J. Vines, another freshman, he's out of Woodstock, Georgia, will replace him in the lineup. Tough having a freshman point guard and then a backup as another freshman, but they're getting better at it.
A little 3-2 point zone right now for North Carolina.
Maddox will try a three. He's got the range, and he drains it. Maddox is one of the top three-point shooters in the ACC, 43.4%. And guess what? Georgia Tech has the lead.
And Maddox is the only guy in the top 10 in the conference in field goal percentage, three-point percentage, and rebounding. That's the kind of year he's having.
Jamison, the lob, a little high for Maktar Jai, and he walked. Anytime someone has gone to a zone this year, it has bothered North Carolina. And right now, Georgia Tech is bothering the heels. Maddox with the three. Georgia Tech with a 1-point lead over North Carolina later today on ABC. We've got more college basketball as Duke tries to rebound against NC State. Massachusetts going against Xavier, and Texas against conference rival Oklahoma today at 3:30 on ABC Sports. Stephon Marbury is there. They also announced Drew Berry and Mark Price as visitors. Here, there's Marbury right in the middle of your picture. Think back to Mark Price. It all started when Bobby Crimmins got a young man out of Enid, Oklahoma as his first big time recruit.
And they said he'd never make it, huh?
Yeah. And then they said he'd never make it in the pros.
What a player. So fast with the ball. Great shooter.
Just pick a league. Mark Price could play in it. Maddox double team. Carter knocked it away, but last touch by Maddox. There's the freshman of the year story. Price was the first one, followed in consecutive years by Dalrymple, Dwayne Farrell, and Tom Hammonds. Then they had Scott Anderson, Martise Moore, and Marbury, and Glover is more than likely to be there before this one's over.
Well, Price, Farrell, Hammonds, and Dalrymple made up a pretty good team in the mid-80s, them all by themselves.
Didn't they ever.
And you add John Sally into the mix, and they were number one to start off the year in 1986.
Maktar Jai gets the last basket. Bynes remains in as the point guard.
North Carolina underrated as a defensive team. They don't really get out in passing lanes, but they don't allow anything into the middle.
Harpering hits a three. Coming into this game, he was only hitting 27% of his long-range shots. That is well off what he has done before, but he has 6 points both on threes today.
But you know what's interesting, Mike, is career three-point percentage is better than Curtis Staples, who's the all-time leader in NCAA threes. That's amazing.
Remarkable. Of course, one of the three-point plays he had was the old-fashioned way, a basket, and there's Harpering defensively. He may have come right under Carter, and Carter went down hard. And Bill Guthridge is up yelling that there should have been a foul on that play. Well, you're so vulnerable, Jay, when you go up like that.
No question, especially when he was reaching behind him. The pass was a little bit behind, so Vince Carter had to take that right arm and stretch it back. Here we'll take another look at the pass from Cota, and you can see, look how he goes behind, and Harpering just gets in under him a little bit, and Vince Carter went down hard, and that, when he was down, kind of a painful reminder of what happened earlier this year to Patrick Ewing. I hope it's not the same result. You'd hate to see Vince Carter taken out of the mix, and there he goes down on that elbow.
Was certainly nothing intentional on Harpering's part. Watch it again, and he really hits the floor hard.
Harpering just trailing the play. You can see he goes up just behind him a bit, and the momentum just carried Vince Carter down to the floor. He's going to be back. He's walking off with the trainer, and Vince Carter is a tough customer.
Out of Daytona Beach, Florida, sort of holding that right arm. And we'll see where the trainer gives him some attention if they put some ice on it. Holding the elbow area, and that's what they'll work on.
Well, I got a funny feeling Vince Carter will test out that right arm with a windmill a little bit later on.
Yeah. Georgia Tech by two, possession of the ball, approaching the 10-minute mark of the first half. Harpering wants it low, double team Maddox for three.
Tell you what, Adamola Okalijah just had a great block out on Matt Harpering. What a defender he is.
They find Harpering in a hurry, and Okalijah, that's the reason he's in that lineup. He'll give you some points occasionally, but he is a tough defender.
And really the consummate role player, and North Carolina has always had one of those.
Bad pass, knocked away, saved, and nice play by Shimon Williams, and then a foul on Vines.
You know, Okalijah really made that play. You could tell that Williams was going to save it, but he came back to the ball. He just didn't stand along the baseline. And that's one of the veteran plays that can be made by this North Carolina team. They've played together so long.
Rare appearance by Brian Burstecker. He will come in for Maktar Jai. He's a freshman, 6'11", out of Virginia Beach. Glover will come back in for Georgia Tech as Maddox will get a breather. Believe it or not, that was the first personal foul on Georgia Tech at the 9:37 mark of the half.
And they are going to stick with this 2-3 zone.
Jamison, that quick shot won't fall for him. He can't get the exact position he can against a man-to-man with that zone, can he?
That's exactly right. And Alvin Jones has done a nice job inside. There's the push on Jamison down low.
Jamison pushed him while he was in the air. That's one on Jamison.
Yeah, Jamison looks a little frustrated. He missed the first shot that he had. He's getting some contact inside against that zone. Also got it in the man-to-man. And he's certainly not getting off to the start he got off to against Duke.
Floyd is in for the first time. He's instant offense for the Jackets. Knocked away by Okalijah. Good anticipation on the pass.
And Georgia Tech really trying to exploit matchups. Right now, Shimon Williams guarding Glover, and Glover's going to post him up.
Deion Glover, pure scorer for this team. His last two ball games put up 47 points.
Right through his hands to Shamon Williams. Glover chasing the play, commits the foul, and it will be on Glover, his first. Made sure that Shamon Williams didn't get the layup after he made the mistake.
And Shamon Williams, Mike, did a very smart thing. He came away limping on that play, but he knew that Glover was going to go after him, so he stayed in front and went off of 2 feet. That way he was able to protect himself, and I think his foot slid out from under him a little bit there. Otherwise, he might have been able to complete that play. But this is a very intelligent play. If you go off of 1 foot, you really expose yourself to getting injured. And there he was able to protect himself. That's a smart play by the senior, Shamon Williams.
One of the best free throw shooters in the history of North Carolina basketball. Earlier in the year, he had 34 in a row. Williams, 4 points today to go with two assists. And lost in what he does is his ability as a playmaker. He's gotten so much better over the years. Of course, Kota makes all the spectacular plays, so nobody ever thinks Shamon Williams.
Well, he's second on the team in assists, and that makes him fifth in the ACC in assists as a two guard. And when Kota goes out, he runs the point and does a terrific job, a very good ball handler.
Floyd got it. Loves to shoot the rock. It's a 2-point lead for Georgia Tech. And it looks, Jay, like they have a lot more confidence than they did at the beginning of the game.
Well, they got off to a good start. Once they started hitting some shots and got into this zone, you can see they feel a lot better about themselves.
Okalija, nice move to get inside the zone, and we're tied at 20.
You know, with Jason Floyd into the ballgame, North Carolina's got to realize you have to make him a driver.
Tipped away by Okalija, picked up by Shamon Williams, dumps it for Okalija. They run the court so beautifully.
And Shamon Williams got down there so quickly and still had the presence of mind to dump it back to Ademola Okalija, who runs the court very well as well.
When there's a loose ball, they sprint to the other end.
Well, the big guys run because they know there's a good chance they'll get it. The guards like to give it up.
Floyd for three, and short. Kota. Great pass to Carter. I guess the arm's all right.
That right arm looks pretty good, doesn't it? You knew he was going to be back, and this team knows each other so well. When that ball went up, Vince Carter knew he could rat out.
Carter by seven. Harpering got free for a moment, trying to get into the lane. Another great spin move, but blocked by Jamison. Floyd for three. Too strong. Had too much time to take the shot, and Harpering commits the, or knocked it out of bounds. I guess no foul call, or is it? Yes, it is on Harpering.
Matt Harpering beat what seemed like four defenders to get to the basket, and his reward was Antoine Jamison.
Official timeout.
First on Harpering, only the third team foul against Georgia Tech. 7:27 to go first half. The Heels by four. 7:27 to go in the half, North Carolina by four. Tomorrow night truly is Big Monday with live coverage of the 6th annual ESPYs. Radio City Music Hall, Norm McDonald will be there. Featured guests, Chris Rock, Alec Baldwin, Matt Damon, Michael J. Fox, many more. And North Carolina's own Dean Smith will receive the Arthur Ashe Courage Award. The ESPYs festivities beginning at 7:30 on ESPN.
Georgia Tech going back to a man-to-man.
Surprise you?
It does, especially how successful they were with that 2-3 zone.
Williams and Kota in the backcourt for North Carolina. Immediately, they get the ball to Jamison. Immediately, he is fouled. They must love to see the man-to-man. He just goes to the spot he wants the ball and gets it.
And he's always moving. That is what makes him so difficult to guard. Usually big guys just anchor themselves down low, but not Antoine Jamison. He moves from side to side. And one of the toughest things to do is guard a man who's moving. Antoine Jamison last year experienced the most problems with defenders when they would muscle him. And he spent a little more time in the weight room this summer, but also had a renewed emphasis on moving without the ball. And he's one of the best in the game at moving without the ball.
Harpering comes back into the ball game. Jamison also worked hard over the summer on his outside shot and free throws. And it really shows in his average, better than 70% this year, going for his sixth point of the day here.
He might as well shoot a good percentage. He gets to the line so often. Yeah. He's the most fouled player in the ACC, followed by Matt Harpering. And when you go to the line, you want to make sure that you're a weapon and you punish people for fouling you.
North Carolina stretching out the lead to six. Carter is guarding Harper.
Jamon Williams really moves his feet defensively very well. Always stays in front.
They collapse all over Harper and kicks it back outside. The three from Spivey.
And that's the shot that Travis Spivey needs to hit. Defenses have been laying off of him.
North Carolina with an answer in a hurry. Jameson scores again.
And he catches it all in one motion. I mean, he gets ready as the ball is getting there and puts it up. He just has a knack for it. I don't even think he can explain what he does.
28-23. Glover cuts all the way in. He said in high school he could go to the hoop anytime he wants. Here, a lot of times he finds people in his way, but not that time.
Well, he's so quick, but that's got to be a charge. You can't get to the basket with one dribble from that far away without somebody stepping in.
Back to the zone. Carter, double clutch.
The hesitation, the presence of mind to switch it in the air. What a great player.
9 points for Vince Carter. Floyd cuts down the lane. Could not get off the shot, but did get it to Maddox. Glover goes baseline, contact, somehow went all the way across and got the loose ball.
See, Mike, North Carolina's playing well, but you can see there's a little edge taken off them from Thursday night.
Only human.
Oh, absolutely.
Maddox inside the three-point line. He missed. Jai with a good block out and a rebound.
But, you know, that's a great point is that championship teams win when they're tired, when they're emotionally drained.
Cota got a little hot dog and threw it away on a behind-the-back pass. Phil Guthridge will not be happy with that. Glover, nice pass inside. Maddox misses the easy shot. Comes back with a tougher follow and score. You know, Cota had that lob the other night that he kicked off the backboard, and everybody just from an athletic standpoint wanted to see it go in, but that's a lot of mustard for your hot dog there.
That's one of the great misses of all time. Showed the athleticism of Vince Carter and the creativity of Vince Cota. But he wouldn't have done that if Dean Smith were over on the bench, I'll bet you.
No, and I'll be real surprised if he does it again, too. 32-27. Carolina's lead is 5 with 4:25 to go in the first half.
Ed Cota really laying off Travis Spivey.
Heartbring for 3. Long rebound to Maddox. He'll try a 3. Got it!
And that's the versatility of Michael Maddox, able to grab a rebound over the top of Maktar Jai. He just took it out to the 3-point line and launched it. And Jai is just not used to that.
Maddox, who averages 13.4 points a game, has 13 in this one, and Georgia Tech is back within 2.
You can see Jai just standing there, and then he realized, oh, geez, he's going to shoot it. Usually big guys that grab an offensive rebound, if they take it back out, they're going to restart the offense, not pull the trigger on a 3.
13 points and 3 rebounds, not a bad first half for Maddox.
And he's had halves like that before, but he has gotten in foul trouble in some key games, Maryland and also Florida State.
Carter from outside.
Boy, pick your poison with Carter. You either go out and play that shot and he goes around you and perhaps puts you on a poster, or you got to let him shoot it.
Carter has a dozen. Here's the steal. Look out. Carter and Cota. Oh.
Ooh. Boy, you really had to worry. When he went up, you just got worried that you're going to leave Spivey underneath you, grab onto the rim and protect yourself, and that's exactly what he did. Great anticipation, getting over the screen by Alvin Jones. That's just outstanding defense. Got to have a pass fake there. And here, he goes up, and Spivey gets under him, and luckily, Carter was able to grab onto the rim and protect himself from an injury.
One of our colleagues, Dan Bonner, tells a great story about playing against David Thompson on a similar play. He said both of his feet hit me in the head as he went by.
That's when you know that all men truly aren't created equal. That whoever said that never played college basketball in the ACC.
That's true. One out of 2. The lead is 6. 3.5 minutes to go in the half. Harpering, working hard, trying to get the ball inside.
And North Carolina really has got probably the best defenders to put on Harpering in Carter and Okalaja of anybody in the league. They can just switch them off and really wear them out.
Maddox double team, taken away by Carter. Gets it to Cota. Takes it in the lane, dumps it off, and Jones with a steal. Not a good play by there. Kota had like a 6-foot jump shot. Wide open. Jones and the foul on Haywood, who just checks in and picks up the first personal.
Just a little over aggressive on his post defense. Haywood did a nice job of pushing him off the lane. You just have to know when to back off when the ball comes in.
We've got a timeout on the court, 2:55 to go. First half, it's a 6-point lead for the Heels. How good is North Carolina's Ed Kota? Well, Thursday, the sophomore point guard from Brooklyn recorded 12 assists against Duke. Last month, he had 10 or more assists in three consecutive games. That's a school record not even the great Phil Ford could match. Quite simply, Kota can deliver the goods. There's his average, 7.7. Phil Ford, thought by many to be the greatest point guard in the history of college basketball, averaged 7 assists. Kota today already has 6. And the Heels on top of the Jackets by half a dozen.
But one thing that both Ed Kota and Phil Ford had were weapons. Phil Ford played with,
yes, sir,
Tommy Lagarde, Michael Corrin. They had some outstanding guys that could finish.
You don't get assists unless the other guy makes the bucket.
And Walter Davis is pretty good, too.
Glover, nice penetration. It wouldn't fall for him.
Nice
Okalija. Oh, pretty pass by Okalija.
You know, they are such a good interior passing team, and Okalija, third on this team in assists, second in rebounds, does all the little things.
Biggest lead of the game. Harpering by Okalija, a little finger roll. Offensive rebound. Guess who? The littlest guy out there, Spivey.
Well, he is not a tall point guard. He's about 6'2", 6'3", but he is a strong one. Was recruited to play football at Miami and actually committed there.
He said, I don't fear anybody on a basketball court, not after playing football. Kota will try the long range shot. Okalija with a tip. Harpering with a rebound. Georgia Tech not getting anything easy. Not a lot of fast break points. The Heels have Spivey, Maddox.
Well, because North Carolina doesn't get out and challenge passes, they'll let you pass it around the perimeter, but getting something inside is very difficult. It seems that like they're not a great defensive team, but they are. They hold their opponents to about 38% shooting on the season.
Harpering measured Okalija for a three. Jones offensive rebound, missed the shot. Maddox offensive rebound, blocked from behind and knocked out of bounds to North Carolina.
The Heels just challenge everything inside, and that's about as good a look as you're going to get against them. Jones with the offensive rebound, and Maddox gets it over Jamison, somewhat improbable, but even then unable to finish or get fouled.
Maktar Jai with nice defense inside, all ball.
And that's what Jai's got to do to be a factor for North Carolina. He's got to block shots and grab rebounds.
He'll try the jump hook at the other end over Jones, and Maktar averages 5.5 points a game, gets a bucket here. Bobby Kremins wants a 20-second timeout to talk about.
Kremins can feel this game getting away a little bit, especially with only 41 seconds left.
Super Tuesday on ESPN tips off at 7:30. A heated Big Ten rivalry. Indiana will face Purdue. It's always a war. Then at 9:30, Arkansas will take on Georgia. It's Indiana-Purdue, Arkansas-Georgia. Super Tuesday on ESPN. Bill Guthridge in his first year, not a bad rookie record, 23-1. His team going to be elevated to number one. He's been around an awful long time, and he just didn't sit there and hold the water bucket for Dean Smith for 31 years.
Oh, absolutely. A lot of the great ideas that Dean Smith got credit for, I'm sure that Bill Guthridge was whispering in his ear, but he has acknowledged that it's a lot tougher to be the decision maker than the guy making the suggestions. But he's done a remarkable job with his staff. Phil Ford, Dave Hanners, and Pat Sullivan. Pat Sullivan said something great the other day. He said, I'm the guy that's replacing Smith. All these guys were on the staff last year. I'm the guy that's got all the pressure.
You got to put that on your stationery. Glover will try a 3 shot clock violation as he missed the rim. That'd look good on your stationery. I'm the guy who replaced Dean. Well, then he can take credit for the 23-1 record.
Well, Bill Guthridge has coached at the highest level of basketball, 30 years with North Carolina. He was an assistant on the 1976 Olympic team with Dean Smith and John Thompson. And that team featured a lot of great players, including our own Quinn Buckner. Scott May was on that team.
You know, what makes it great is that he passed on several opportunities to be a head coach at other programs. The loyalty he showed to North Carolina and to Dean Smith, and to see that rewarded at this stage of his career in this situation with the one of the top programs that's ever existed was really a remarkable thing. Loose ball, Glover took it away, and Glover will go the other way for the jam. At the buzzer, it counts. Let's see what kind of a turnaround that is. That's really a four-point possible swing. Georgia Tech cuts the lead to six as Glover goes the length of the court. Jay, that's a big, big play.
Well, it's a play because it takes 2 points away from North Carolina on the turnover. And Glover did a great job of recognizing the clock and just getting it in there before time went out. That's a huge play.
We're at the half. We'll be back to the Thriller Dome in just a moment. Welcome back to Alexander Memorial Coliseum, where North Carolina leads Georgia Tech 40-34. What a year it's been for first-year head coach Bill Guthridge. He's made the transition from Dean Smith's leadership seamless. And as ESPN's Curry Kirkpatrick reports, Guthridge has impressed his players and coaching staff.
If I can't give this team that enthusiasm, I said I would get out.
Thank you.
Bill Guthridge, that unassuming little guy in the glasses, the one who sat silently beside the legend for 30 years, the man who would stop the tears, quell the fears, and carry the Tar Heels' torch into the future, was a 60-year-old career assistant named Bill Guthridge. Wasn't the apprentice staying as much a surprise as the dean's leaving?
I don't think he surprised anybody. The only people I believe surprises the media and some quote-unquote wannabe fans.
Anybody who knows about the program from the inside knows that the truth is that the players were closer and spent more time with Bill Guthridge over the last 10 years than they had Dean Smith.
I think my relationship with the players is pretty much the same as it has always been. I was never the good guy and the good guy, bad guy. In fact, I did a lot of the discipline as far as academic work and being on time and that type of thing.
But amid their sea change, the Tar Heels have been nothing except very, very good. Their excellence in the ACC is same old, but the difference under their same old new guy is how the team plays, calm, free, and relaxed.
I think we're a little bit more laid back than we was last year. But Coach Smith, you know, he's going over this and going over that, and he's kind of intense a little bit. But with Coach Guthridge, I mean, he just has this smoothness about him.
They've had a couple plays where there were two behind-the-back passes on one play, and you know, under Dean Smith, not only would those two guys who threw the behind-the-back passes, would they be sitting down, the other three would be down for aiding and abetting.
I'm not purposely letting them get away with things. I think, you know, Dean didn't mind the behind-the-back pass, or he liked dunks too, as long as they're successful, and that's what I tell our team.
Guthridge also will not hesitate to show his own wry side.
Sometimes he'll say things that it'll be a tense moment, but he'll say something that is just really hilarious that'll crack you up.
Still no new developments in Iraq or on the Whitewater situation. So now we can get on to important things.
When Coach Smith cracked the joke, I mean, everybody was just, it was in shock because he was one of them guys who, you know, he smiled every once in a while, but with Coach Guthridge, I mean, when he's not, you know, joking, it's a shock.
Even the staff parking lot here at the Dean Dome reflects the stark change to a freer, more open basketball society. Ground Zero used to be a sign looming over Dean Smith's personal spot. It warned everybody else, no parking anytime. But now the sign's gone, and all kinds of commoners, including visiting media types, have found a way to sneak onto this once hallowed ground.
Coach Guthridge, he asked us our input, you know, should it might, what do we see out there? You know, what kind of defenses do we see? You know, do we see any players that might, you know, work out there and things like that?
Things that the old coach might have an opinion on as well. Nobody figured the icon Smith would totally disappear, did they?
Now I'm asking him advice, and he's giving it, and then I have to make the decision. I kind of liked it the other way. You don't have to live with suggestions. You have to live with decisions.
The greatest debt of gratitude that the University of North Carolina owes to Dean Smith is for how he left and the condition that he left the program in, giving it to Bill Guthridge at a time when the team was very good.
This is a veteran team, and it's the first veteran team that we've had around here in quite some time. But they still have to be coached. They still have to play together. And they still have to believe in the person that is their leader. And fortunately, that person is Coach Guthridge.
Welcome back to the Thriller Dome in Atlanta, where the Tar Heels of North Carolina have a six-point lead on Georgia Tech. Mike Patrick, Jay Billis with you. Hope you join us tomorrow night, because it truly will be Big Monday. Live coverage of the sixth annual ESPY Awards from Radio City Music Hall. Norm MacDonald will be your host. You'll see Chris Rock, Matt Damon, Michael J. Fox, and many, many more presenting awards. And North Carolina's own Dean Smith will be there to receive the Arthur Ashe Award for Courage. The ESPYs tomorrow night, festivities beginning at 7:30 on ESPN. Always an interesting show. Hope you'll join us for that. And Jay Billis and I will be back to talk about the first half here. Very interesting ball game. Hope you'll stay with us. Back in a moment.
Track and field team are Len Houston and Andrea King, a senior high jumper from
40-34, North Carolina leading Georgia Tech at the half. They've had the lead most of the time, and very, very impressive, especially when they run, Jay. It's just remarkable to see these guys get out in the open court, and that means it's showtime for Vince Carter.
And they started out very well. North Carolina got off to the 10-5 lead, and then Georgia Tech went to a 2-3 zone and really got back into the ball game. But really, the story in the first half for North Carolina was Vince Carter. He was spectacular as usual, but he was also solid. Here's a look at the spectacular, that first half dunk, and he just cocks this thing and sends it down in a hurry. Carter had 13 points in the first half. Also had three steals. And for Georgia Tech, Michael Maddox was the guy that was matching Vince Carter, grabbing the rebound over Maktar Jai and taking advantage of the big guy by taking him out to the three-point line and draining it. Maddox also had 13 points in that first half, and he did a nice job on the boards as well as adding to those points.
But one of the differences in the first half, you mentioned the 2-3 zone. It was very effective. That's what Maryland did when they beat North Carolina, the Heels' only loss. But Matt Harpering only had 6 points. He had the three-point shot from outside, had one field goal inside, and a free throw. That's it.
And the field goal inside was when he walked with it and it didn't get called. He got the three-point play off of it. But I think that's attributable to the great defense that North Carolina put on Matt Harpering. Most notably, Vince Carter and Adamola Okalaja. Both are big, both are strong, and both are very quick. And they fought Harpering tooth and nail for every possession.
All right, 40-34. We'll be back with the second half from the Thriller Dome in just a moment. Stay with us. Tar Heels by 6 over the Jackets at the half. Let's take a look at the first half statistics. And for the 10th time this year, North Carolina shoots over 60% for the half. They shot 61.5. We rounded it off to 62. Georgia Tech not bad at 43. The free throws, 5 out of 6 for the Heels. 3-point field goals, they hit 3 out of 7, while Tech hit only 3 out of 13. Georgia Tech actually with an edge in rebounds and 13 first half assists for North Carolina. And Jay and I were saying off the air, if you can survive 62% shooting in the first half and be within 6, you're doing pretty well.
They've got to be very happy with that. Bobby Kremins in the locker room has to feel that this is about as good as it can get when the other team shoots 62% and you only grab 9 offensive rebounds to try to stick with them. But really what happened to end that first half, Mike, is North Carolina really threw away a golden opportunity. They could have scored to end the half. Then they have the ball to start out the second half. That's how championship teams get those mini runs going and methodically blow other teams out. When you're on the road, you really can't afford to give up those opportunities.
There's the comparison of the superstars. They really haven't been the offensive story. Jamison with 10, Harpering with 6. Harpering's done his job on the boards, but You know, these guys, in addition to being great players, are very unselfish players. If someone else is getting the opportunities and getting the baskets, they are not going to force it. And I don't think either one of them cares if they get 28 points or 13. It's the success of the team that's paramount to them.
And that's the difference, really, in Matt Harpring this year. Last year, he didn't have the weapons along with him, so he had to take shots each and every time down. That put an awful lot of pressure on his game. This year, if it's not there right away, he can give it up to Deion Glover, Michael Maddox, or Travis Spivey, and they can score for him.
Keep it here on the Deuce. We've got more hoops coming your way tomorrow night at 9 o'clock. Eddie Sutton's Oklahoma State Club goes to Ames, Iowa to face Iowa State. And at 11 o'clock, SMU against San Jose State. It's a double dip on the Deuce tomorrow night as college basketball winds its way through February. Carolina's basketball, Carter to inbound to Ed Cota.
Georgia Tech will start out the second half in the 2-3 zone that was so successful for them in the first half, and they trapped the first pass.
Cota, 6 assists, but 4 turnovers in the first half. Almost has another one and does. The pass ahead to Harpring. Carter is back. Harpring somehow kept it and missed the shot. Oh, man, what a great play on his part. And then Maktar Jai came from behind to put pressure on him.
I think his football background helped him out a little bit on that catch.
Carter did everything he could. Somehow Harpring kept it alive and then couldn't finish it.
Georgia Tech going man-to-man. Could be a zone off a make, man off the miss.
Ball is out of bounds to Carolina. With 13 on the shot clock. They get it to Maktar Jai right under the basket. He traveled. It has not been a good day offensively for Maktar Jai.
Well, that's one of those plays. North Carolina runs their out-of-bounds under plays to score. They don't run them just to get the ball in to set up their offense. But sometimes when you're the guy taking the ball out of bounds, you have to assess where you're giving it to a guy. In other words, are you putting him in a position where he can be successful? And Jai was just too far under the basket.
Harpring off the air ball from Glover. Glover will tell everybody that was a pass later, but no one will believe him.
And you know, well, he'll get that story from Derek Wittenberg, who's sitting over on the bench with him.
That's right. Cota with a turnover. That is sixth as he travels. And Georgia Tech can cut into a 4-point lead.
And you can see, Mike, that as hard as they are trying, this veteran team, the edge is off just a little bit. And that happens. There's really almost nothing you can do about it. It's kind of like just playing when you're tired after they got back from the Alaska trip. They just have to play their way through it and fight.
This one's tipped out of bounds, and it will be out to Carolina.
These are the games that, if North Carolina is able to come away with a win in a tough place on the road, where a coach will come into his press conference and say how proud he is of his team, that they really fought through a difficult period. And that's what winning teams and championship teams do time after time.
Great teams win games when they don't play their best. Jamison got it low, double teamed and fouled.
Now, Antoine Jamison has got great hands. That was made by the catch, really. A difficult pass by Shamon Williams. Jamison able to get his mitts on it and get it up and gets the foul against Spivey underneath.
Two on Spivey, and Spivey was wolfing a little bit at Antoine Jamison after the play. I'd find somebody else. I don't care how tough you are.
Yeah, you like the guts of that, but not the smarts.
Yeah. Go find a walk-on.
Yeah, that's what I used to do. I used to go yell at the guys on the bench. Come on, you guys, anytime.
11 points, 4 boards. Jamison has really improved at the free throw line. As Jay said in the first half, you have to punish people that are going to whack in. He's going to get whacked an awful lot.
Well, fouling him used to be a good percentage play. It's not anymore.
Harpring fell down somehow, got the ball to Spivey. Maddox for 3, got it. Maddox has made some big shots in this game.
You know what was so impressive about that, Mike, is he set up along the three-point line and got his feet ready as the ball was coming to him. So it was just a catch and a shot.
Maddox with 16 points. Jamison down low. Pressure on him, and it won't go. That's something Duke was not able to do the other night. Collapse around Jamison. Harpring for 3. Would have tied it. Here they come on a run. Carter trying to get in position. They feed it to Jamison instead, and he'll get the jam.
That's the way you answer a guy who's been talking to you a little bit. Travis Spivey got to see up close what Antoine Jameson was all about.
Maddox had a three, passed on it. One of the things that makes Carolina's defense so great is that they are all so big, and yet they're very quick. You just can't get much space to work in there. Bad pass by Glover. It's picked off by Shamon Williams.
And they know each other's tendencies defensively. It's a good play.
Shamon for three. If you let him shoot from the top of the circle, put it in the book. It's over.
Yeah, everybody was going down underneath the basket, and that's the kind of opportunistic three that you like to see a guy like Shamon Williams take in transition. And you knew, I mean, you knew it was going in as soon as he let it go.
47-39. We said about Maddox, he had hit some big shots. Every time it looked like Carolina was really starting to blow it open, Maddox was the guy who made a bucket.
And here you can see in transition, Shamon Williams coming down, giving that little shot fake, and Jameson just running the court. Here, everybody runs down underneath to protect the basket. The first thing you got to do is stop the ball. And very intelligently, Shamon Williams assessed the situation and pulled up for the three where he is at his most deadly.
They already lead the nation, shooting much better than their average today. And from three-point range, they've hit 4 out of 8, while Georgia Tech is only 4 out of 16.
You know, it's not really an aberration for North Carolina to be a good shooting team from the field. 8 of the last 11 years coming into this year, they've led the conference in field goal percentage.
Floyd for three. He hits a big shot.
You have to make Jason Floyd put the ball on the floor. He is a three-point shooter.
The lead is 5. Carter over Harpering. Foul on Jameson. And Antoine Jameson can't believe it. He's the one he thought he was pushed.
And he may be right. Antoine Jameson gets off of his feet so well. Here you see the shot go up, and he will not allow himself to be blocked out. Just a touch of contact, and it looked like he really was getting the inside position.
Harpering got it. It's a three-point game. Georgia Tech keeps coming back. But every time so far, North Carolina has had the answer.
Well, I'm telling you, Georgia Tech is not a team with a 3-6 record. I mean, that's what it says in the league. But they have played very, very well this year. This is a completely different ball club than finished last in the ACC last season.
And Matt Harpering has just gone over the 2,000-point barrier, the 6th player in Georgia Tech history to do it. He has 2,001 in his brilliant career in Atlanta. Georgia Tech has pulled within 3. Matt Harpering hitting this jump shot to cut it to 47-44. He goes over the 2,000-point mark, the 6th ever. Yonkus, Price, Scott, Hammonds, and Best. The last 5 of those 6, all from the Bobby Crimmins era.
And Matt Harpering very soon, I think, will have his number retired for the play that he has exhibited his last 4 years here at Georgia Tech. And I think also for the fact that he stayed with this program instead of going pro at the really the easiest time for a guy to leave after a tough year.
Yeah, really just a tremendous thing for him to do, and it shows the quality of person that he is. Georgia Tech in that zone with 13 on the shot clock. Maktar Jai, bad pass, really ripped one at the feet of Shamon Williams. 11 turnovers for the Heels.
Not sure Alex Rodriguez could have caught that with his Rawlings glove on.
Spivey is in there. This half, the Heels with 4 turnovers. Harpering to tie.
Well, I'll tell you what, Mike. You let a guy like Matt Harpering get started, and I'm not sure what you can do to stop him. But it's all over. I mean, he starts feeling it. You have got to get out on him.
I think the only answer is to give it to Jameson on this end. Cota with 6 assists and 6 turnovers. Shamon Williams with his great eye drains it out of the corner.
Now, how many times have we said over the course of the last 2 years that Shamon Williams hits big shots? Seems like when North Carolina needs a basket, Shamon Williams is the guy that steps to the fore.
They must have ruled Harpering's last basket a 2. Jones with a tip in off the Harpering miss, because it, instead of tied, it was a 1-point game before the North Carolina 3. Williams again. Shamon Williams.
trying to silence the crowd and doing a very good job of it. But he's not going to do it by putting his index finger to his lips. He's going to do it by continuing to drain those threes. And Alvin Jones picking up a freshman foul there. Nothing to be gained by getting in to Maktar Jai like that. Just takes the ball out of your hands. And Shamon Williams, what a player. Last year, the MVP of the ACC tournament, also the NCAA Eastern Regional.
He's a guy that 16 today.
And he's a guy that plays with a chip on his shoulder. And he's been overlooked for so long. People have maligned his ball handling, but he's a terrific player.
Coda to Jamison. Just so quick off his feet. You hardly ever see him get a shot blocked. Lead is quickly back to 7.
They always answer the bell, don't they?
Yes, they do. Floyd had the 3 and passed on it. Coda took it away from him. Floyd turned his head for an instance, and Coda was right there. Williams! Oh, man! 3 in the space of about a minute 20.
And how about Ed Coda pulling that ball back out and then finding Shamon Williams? Did a little pirouette just outside the top of the key.
And Shamon Williams with 19 points. They get the lead back up to 10. Just at the point that Georgia Tech got within 1.
This is a team that knows each other so well. You can see Williams getting the pass and again trying to silence the crowd, but he's doing it by deed rather than by word. And Williams was outstanding on Thursday night against Duke. He had 17 points, hit 2 of 3 from three-point land in the first half. And it's amazing that North Carolina could put up 97 points against a team like Duke and only hit 2 threes.
Yeah, it's just ridiculous. And look what Shamon has done today. 5 out of 6 from three-point range. He has 19 points. The Heels as a team, 7 out of 11 from long range. And Georgia Tech's going to have to make another comeback.
And they always have a guy that steps up to kill you.
And more than one. Here's the steal by Williams. He does it at both ends. Offensive foul on Okalijah. Pushed off with a free arm. That's his first. Very few fouls in a well-officiated ball game. Rick Hartzell, Mike Wood, and Zelton Steed are the officiating crew.
We had a terrific game from an officiating standpoint Thursday night. That
was
North Carolina game. Frank Scagliata, Larry Rose did an outstanding job.
Yes, they did. The lead is 10. We're at the 13-minute, 10-second mark. Maddox been quiet lately. It hits the baseline jumper.
That's just a smart play by Michael Maddox. He knew that he could face up and take Maktar Jai, but he turned away from the double team. Vince Carter coming down from the wing. And Maddox just didn't give him a chance to get there.
16 for Maddox. Jamison gets it off to Carter. Hangs for the jump shot. Rebound to Spivey. Georgia Tech has always had excellent rebounding guards.
And Glover's among them.
Glover cuts to the hole and put it in. It's a 6-point lead. Boy, both of these teams really showing a lot of class.
That's where Deion Glover's at his best. And he slaps the floor saying that this is a big defensive possession. I'm telling you, North Carolina's going to take that as a challenge.
Yes, they will. Shamon Williams, you can see his eyes light up. Carter will try a 3. Offensive rebound to Jamison, knocked away. Shamon Williams got it back to Jai, out to Carter. 3-second violation.
Georgia Tech just will not go away. You know, they play so tough, especially in this building, but that's the way they've been all season long. Last year, you could see when things started to go south on them. Some of the players, I think, gave up a little bit, but that is not happening at all this year. They faced some adversity, being 3-6 in the league, had some tough losses, but they just keep coming back and coming back.
They have had only 2 more turnovers than North Carolina, and that has kept them in the ballgame. Floyd,
when you think about the job Bobby Kremitz has done in this program, has the third longest tenure all time for an ACC coach.
Floyd for 3 with the miss. He has really brought some excitement to this program, which was lower than low. They had nothing. Shamon Williams has hit 4 three-pointers here in the second half. He has 21 points at 60-52. Boy, he's been the jacket killer today here in the second half.
Here's the guy that's really got to keep it going is Maddox.
Floyd's open in the corner. He loves that shot. That was partially tipped. Maktar Jai got a hand on it. Excellent defense.
Well, one thing they didn't do, Mike, is probe into that defense by trying to find a gap in the zone. When you can dribble into those gaps, you freeze the defenders, and that can open up something for a teammate. Great play.
Shimon Williams, great pass. Maddox commits the foul. Glover is down holding his ankle. Well, Shimon Williams, Dean Smith even admitted it. The first 2 years, it scared him when Shimon Williams had the basketball because he wasn't a very good dribbler. He has worked on it. You can tell how hard he has worked on it. And now he is far better than an average point guard when he has the opportunity to run the club.
Well, Shimon Williams' best friend is the night watchman at the Dean Smith Center because he is in there night after night into the wee hours shooting, working on his ball handling all by himself. And you can see that it's really paid off. Earlier this season when Ed Cota was out, Shimon Williams stepped in against Richmond, ran the team, had over 20 points, had 13 assists, only one turnover in 37 minutes.
And all this basically from a kid who was unwanted coming out of high school. Nobody really looked at him as a major college player. Off North Carolina, out of bounds to Georgia Tech.
Official timeout.
10:52 to go in the game. We have a timeout. The Tar Heels leading the Jackets by 8. 60-52 with 10:52 to go in the ballgame. Shimon Williams has had 14 points in the second half. That's why Carolina still has the lead.
When Georgia Tech cut the lead to one, one guy answered the bell for North Carolina, and it was Shimon Williams, the senior, draining threes, and he had a little message for the crowd that they needed to quiet down because he was going to take over. And Shimon Williams, when he steps on the road or at home, he can be absolutely deadly. 7 out of 10 for the ball game, 5 of 6 from three-point range. That's a stellar performance.
Does Georgia Tech have another run left in it? Jones is back in the ball game. Glover trying to go to the hole. Maddox with a floater and hit it. Well, Maddox has hit the big shots all day long. He has 20.
And Maddox at times has had some big first halves but hasn't carried it forward in the second half, sometimes because of foul trouble. But he's done a nice job here in this second half of continuing to be active offensively and presenting himself as an option.
Williams got by Glover. Couldn't do anything with it.
Tech back to man-to-man.
Williams will try a tough three over two defenders, and he buried it. Holy cow, he has 24. That was a tough shot.
I think Georgia Tech better consider the one in box. Put the box on Williams and the yeah. One can guard everybody else.
He's hit 6 out of 7 threes and almost stole this one from Vines. Excuse me, that was Cota who knocked it out of bounds. Shimon Williams just on fire. He really challenged him that time. He says, okay, keep coming out, keep coming out. Boom, in your face.
And that just shows the depth of talent that this team has, not only talent but experience, that they can go that deep, and Shimon Williams is the guy that can kill you.
Maddox hits a three. He has 23 points, one off of his career high. Boy, they're just devastating. When they get the offense going at 65-57, 15 for Carter.
So good in the low post. He took that right at Alvin Jones. Second best shot blocker in the country. And Vince Carter at 6'5 went right into him.
Maddox passed on the three that time. Shimon Williams doing a nice job defensively. Jumping out there trying to get in the passing lane in front of Harpring. Okalaja with a rebound. Cota to Jamison. Double little scoop.
Didn't it look like he was going to lay it off to Williams on the right-hand side, then came back to the other option, Jamison?
67-57. Bobby Crimmins wants to talk about it before it slips away even further. 8:46 to go in the game. Back after this.
60,000 students have benefited because of Hope Scholarships.
It hasn't been easy for them, but North Carolina leading Georgia Tech by 10 with 8:46 to go. Need an extra dose of college hoops? ESPN College Basketball Full court pay-per-view can make all of your hoop dreams come true. More games, great conference action, even a special late season rate. Call 1-800-GET-SPORTS or your local cable company. Georgia Tech needs to dial in a two or a three right here. Spivey is in to run the club. Got it to Harpering in the corner.
North Carolina sticking with their point zone, trying to pack it in, but still recover to three-point shooters.
Jones wheels into the lane, made it a tough shot. Glover, what a follow.
Glover is a very effective offensive rebounder and often gets a running start. And out of a zone defense, very difficult to define blockout responsibilities and go out and lay a body on it.
Well, look at Harpering step up the defensive intensity. Here comes Cota. Okalijah. Harpering with a rebound. Harpering somehow maintained control and he missed a shot. Just couldn't finish it after the great play. Shamon Williams wants the ball. You would too if you'd made every shot you've seen in the last 8 minutes.
But intelligently pulls it out, running some clock, just as important now as getting a score.
Nearly had it taken away as he tried to drive and then throws it away to Spivey. Two on one, Spivey and Glover. And Glover saved it in the corner. And then knocked out of bounds. Well, there was a blown opportunity. It looked like Glover was waiting to do something spectacular.
And Spivey took it too far.
Yeah.
You got to pull it back out. When you got a two-on-one, get a little bit wider. They made it far too easy on Ed Cota by staying too close together.
Georgia Tech trying to do the job on the boards.
And when have you seen a stat like that this season? Georgia Tech
never
dominating the offensive glass.
Harpering free for the 12-footer and drains it.
You can't gamble on Matt Harpering.
He has 14 points. It's back to six. And we've got a 20-second timeout.
You know, on that last play, Antoine Jamison took a shove from Alvin Jones. He was not at all happy about it. He's not the type to go after another player, but I would imagine that on this other end, he is going to be posting with a little bit of extra incentive to get the ball.
To me, that is the greatest player in Georgia Tech history. Mark Price, just, he was the coldest shooter I think I've ever seen. He just drained them all.
Led the ACC in scoring as a freshman, and it's not like there weren't some pretty good scorers in that conference, and Michael Jordan, Ralph Sampson, Johnny Dawkins.
When he played, I'll never forget, when they went to the ACC tournament, it was one against five. Mark Price against the other team, and he darn near beat everybody. He was just unbelievable. Cota straight down the lane, tries to dump it off, but there was nobody there. Bad pass by Cota, and he has had his problems with turnovers this afternoon.
And there's Bill Guthridge, not negative at all, just keeping his troops, their spirits up. He knows how difficult of a game this is to play, given what they went through last week.
The rhythm of this game, Jay, has been amazing, hasn't it? The way they just keep coming back. Harpering, tough pass to Jones. Loose ball. Jones somehow got it back. Then it's kicked by Jamison, and that will give it back to Georgia Tech.
Now, I'll tell you what, coming out of high school, Alvin Jones had the reputation as a big guy who was soft. And that's really the worst thing you can say about a big guy, but he doesn't look soft to me. He's been going after it all year long, and he just took that ball away from Shamon Williams. And there Jamison with the kick to give it back to Georgia Tech. But this is an important possession. They're two possessions down, 6 points. If they can get a score here, that'll get the crowd really into this game and put some more game pressure on North Carolina when they've got to be fatigued.
If Jones is soft, give me a bunch of other soft guys.
No question.
Shot clock at 13 for Spivey. Maddox.
Nice pass.
Oh, that came out. Jones with a follow after the Glover missed. You're right, it was a beautiful pass, and they cut it to four. Ball game, Mrs. Pitt.
And now all of a sudden the crowd is making this a different atmosphere.
Cota, great pass to Jamison. And somehow it goes straight from where he catches it right in the basket.
Well, I'm still trying to figure out how he caught it. And he caught it and scored before anybody even knew it was going in there.
16 for Jamison. Jones wants the ball down low, backing it on Jai. Kicked it outside for Maddox. A three won't go. Jones kept it alive again. Saved by Spivey, and he got the timeout before he fell out of bounds. Jones has made a couple of big plays. Sometimes, oh no, he didn't get the timeout.
I think Mike Wood had called that he had stepped on the line as he was going after it.
Sometimes you can't get the ball, and you have to realize that and tip it as he did three times in a row.
Just have to keep going after, give your teammates a chance.
Jamison again, this one spins out. Harpering with players all over the floor.
Look how he gets on the floor after it.
Spivey kicks it to Maddox. Well, you can tell the tension has been turned up a couple of notches here. Harpering for three. Fell back a little bit on that one. Glover with a follow against Jai. He doesn't fear anybody.
And you know, Mike, you know who made that play? Was Matt Harpering. He was the guy that dove on the floor for the loose ball when Shamon Williams was bending over at the waist. When your All-American is doing that, you know you got a shot.
Glover has a dozen. It is a four-point lead. Somehow Georgia Tech always plays Carolina and Duke this hard here in Atlanta. And Jamison showing a little range. He answers with the jump shot.
The heart of a champion.
You can say that about several guys out there.
You really can, but I'm not sure there's a tougher guy mentally than Matt Harpering. If there is, it's Antoine Jamison.
The top two offensive players, the top two rebounding players in the ACC. And against great competition every night. Jones put the ball on the floor. Harpering got it, and he's fouled. Either Jamison or Jai. Let's see who gets it. Jamison. That will be his third. Nobody in any real foul trouble on either club.
You know, Matt Harpering steps to the line now, and it is a reminder that that's not a place he spent a lot of time in this ballgame. North Carolina does a terrific job against Harpering of playing tough defense without fouling him. He does not get easy points.
Harpering, if he makes both, can cut it to four. He is sixth in the ACC in free throw shooting.
North Carolina substitution.
Okalijah will come back in, and Shamon Williams will get a breather. I'm sure Georgia Tech is just happy to see Shamon Williams sit down. Harpering hits them both. 3:56 to go in the game, and plays like this have made it something special here in Atlanta this afternoon. 3:56 to go. Stephon Marbury trotted out his Sunday finest out of the jewelry closet. He's looking sharp this afternoon in a four-point lead for North Carolina. What do you got? I mean, I've got a class ring and a watch. That's about it.
Nothing to compete, but what we do have is a great basketball game. It's just classic ACC matchup, and Georgia Tech has always played North Carolina tough in this building today. Absolutely no exception. They've gone after it from start to finish.
Especially under Bobby Crimmins. He just seems to find a way. And he's got it within four.
Georgia Tech going to stick with that 2-3 zone. They like to trap along the sidelines. And Vince Carter does a nice job of getting it back out to Cota. And Cota's got to find a seam in this.
Okalijah Harpering working hard to keep Jamison from getting the ball. Shot clock is at seven, knocked away. Carter gets it back, tries a three, won't go. Okalijah offensive rebound and a new 35 on the shot clock. Big offensive rebound.
And that's two great plays by Maktar Jai. The first one was knocking the ball back out on the bad pass inside. He was the guy that kept that ball alive and kept possession of North Carolina.
The Heels taking their time as we approach 3 minutes. Okalijah, seven on the shot clock, whistle away from the ball, a foul on Jones.
And he's been given a shot to Antoine Jamison every time he goes through the lane. And this is a tight, intense ball game. But if you look over at Bill Guthridge, he looks like he's sitting in Sunday school.
Georgia Tech substitution number 34.
He couldn't be more calm and relaxed.
No. Carolina number 3, Shimon Williams. Jones comes out. Floyd comes in. Non-shooting foul. But they do get a fresh 35 seconds. And there's only 2:54 to go in the game. Bobby Kerman's calling out the defense.
North Carolina going to take their time against this zone. But they still have to be aggressive offensively, even if they run a little bit of clock. The last thing you want to do is run it down to 10 seconds and then get a bad shot.
Which they have done twice in a row. Really haven't gotten anything out of it. Shimon Williams with a tough pass. Oh, Elijah gets the bucket. Or excuse me, Carter.
And there was some contact up top that wasn't called. Vince Carter still strong enough to complete that play.
Carter has 17. The lead is back to 6. Floyd, lazy pass, picked off. And ahead of the back, Oak Elijah. That may be the backbreaker. A sophomore mistake from Floyd.
And one thing that Georgia Tech did not do was get back after the turnover and allow the easy score.
.203 to go in the game, so after getting within 4 again, the lead is expanded to 8. We'll be back to the Thriller Dome after this. .75-67, .203 to go in the ball game, and Jay, there are certain times in a game, certain situations, where you just know as a player that you have to score, and I think that last possession was one of them. Instead, they get the turnover, and North Carolina gets the easy layup.
I think that's exactly right. And the guy who got it done was Vince Carter. Got it done on the offensive end, making a tough basket underneath, and then taking away that pass from Jason Floyd, trying to get it inside. And you called it. It was a floater, not a strong pass. And Carter made him pay for it, immediately looked up court. And Travis Spivey, a freshman as well, did not get back defensively. And North Carolina just makes you pay for little mistakes.
Great balance for North Carolina's big three. Williams with 24, Jamison 22, Carter with 17. And Georgia Tech desperately needing a bucket here.
One of the things North Carolina has to do right now is defend the three-point line.
Glover with a floater in the lane, and he hit it. 6-point margin.
Georgia Tech has to go back to man-to-man. They got to keep some pressure on.
Spivey on Cota. Spivey will commit the foul. That will be the 6th team foul against Georgia Tech.
Foul, 11,
Cota, a very good free throw shooter, about 82%, but he will not get the opportunity because it's only the 6th team foul.
Bobby Crimmins wants a 20-second timeout to tell his ball club. And right now, you know, Bobby Crimmins, I think, has the harder job at this point because he's got so much youth on his club. And there's only so much you learn during that freshman year about special situations like this.
But Bobby Crimmins, one thing that he's done all year long, he's kept up his enthusiasm and he's kept coaching game in and game out. He is educating these players as they go along in each key situation, even when they're down. He's working them through, trying to get them to think game situation so they'll be ready when the time comes. And really, it's too bad that they don't have an older team for Matt Harpring and Michael Maddox in their last year.
Later today on ABC, you'll see these games, Duke battling NC State, UMass against Xavier, or Texas against arch rival Oklahoma, today at 3:30 on ABC. Hope you'll switch over for that. We have 1:37 to go here. Jamison gets the ball right back, and Harpring commits an intentional foul. They hardly ever call it in this situation, but he stopped Jamison from scoring.
North Carolina on their out-of-bounds sideline did a nice job of getting an isolation, got the ball back to the inbound man, who immediately gave it to Antoine Jamison, streaking toward the basket. And there, Kevin Cantwell, longtime assistant of Bobby Crimmins, trying to figure out a way to get some points on the board without allowing North Carolina to score. But the Tar Heels just so tough. And when you have a veteran ball club like this, they're just so difficult to beat. They know how to win on the road. And that's a tough thing to do in this league.
Jamison makes 1 out of 2. He has 23 points. The lead is 7. Maddox backs up, takes the 3. Boys hit some huge shots.
Boy, they're calling it a 2. He had just a toenail on the line.
He thought he had backed up and gotten the three.
And that's a big one, too, because that would have made it a two-possession game.
76-71. They'll commit the foul. Foul number five, Deion
Glover, that's his second. Just had that toe right on the line. Mike Wood right on top of it, calling it a two. So North Carolina leads by five with the opportunity to get it back up to seven.
And here's the last guy in the face of the earth you want to foul, Shamon Williams.
I'll tell you what, Mike, he might still be on that consecutive free throw streak if not for that game against Clemson where he was really frozen by the referees. There was a long period from the time the foul was committed till the time he got to take his shot.
Williams makes them both, and really the only answer, if you're going to foul the good free throw shooters, you have to have threes at the other end, and Shamon Williams has matched his career high of 26 points. Offensive rebound to Jones. He wants to kick it outside to Maddox. Glover going baseline. Jamison blocks it. Harpering has it, puts it up, and he's fouled.
Well, if you can't get the three from outside the arc, Matt Harpering can get it for you the old-fashioned way. Glover getting the ball along the baseline. How about that block by Antoine Jamison coming over the top? And Harpering goes after it with both hands. He's just got the knack of always being around the basketball. Won't allow himself to get blocked out and just push Vince Carter underneath. And went right in and sought out the contact, which is what veteran players do inside.
I think if Carter had that one to rethink, he might have just gotten out of the way, let him have the two.
Oh, absolutely. You certainly don't want to foul, stop the clock, and allow your opponent to set up its press after a free throw.
Bodies fly. It's down to four. So they get the three-pointer the old-fashioned way again. Jamison is fouled in backcourt. Keep in mind that in overtime against Maryland, Jamison had played so many minutes and was so tired, he had one out of five free throws down the stretch of that game. And that cost Carolina a chance to win. So maybe this is the guy to go after in the hope that he's tired. He was one out of two from the line last time.
And North Carolina, really, when you mention that game, could and probably should be undefeated. Maryland did a terrific job. Certainly don't want to take anything away from that victory. But North Carolina had their opportunities to win that game. And I think most observers who have seen North Carolina over the years were surprised that the Heels didn't make those plays down the stretch.
They had the situations where over the years you say, well, here it comes. And they would miss the shot or miss the three-on-one fast break. Jamison misses the free throw. And Harpering is fouled on the rebound. That could be huge. Holy cow.
And that is not a play that you often see veteran teams make. But North Carolina was in a position to foul because it's only the fifth team foul, so they don't put Georgia Tech on the other end. You had to look up right away to the scoreboard to make sure that they weren't in the one and one.
Jackets have to hurry. Spivey against Cota. And the foul on Ed Cota. That will be the fifth team foul. They still can get one more before they'll go to the line. And each one takes a few seconds off the clock.
And it disrupts Georgia Tech's offense. They're not able to get a shot up.
Harpering trying to go inside. Tough leaner. He missed it. Rebound to Glover. Tried to spin it back up. Tip Jamison with a rebound. And Jamison is fouled. Georgia Tech with a couple of chances from point blank range, couldn't convert. 40.9 seconds to go, and they'll send Jamison back
Georgia
to the line.
Georgia Tech foul on number 34, Jason Floyd. That's his second, 10th team foul.
Here you can see Matt Harpering looking for that contact against Vince Carter, and Carter just backing off a little bit. And Glover couldn't get that shot to go, and that's where you gotta gather yourself and go up strong. Glover trying to avoid the block rather than going into the contact to seek the foul.
Jamison, 23 points. He's 5 out of 7 from the line. May get 6 out of 8, but only 2 of his last 4. 5-point lead. Still a 2-possession ball game.
Boy, this is one of those games that if North Carolina hangs on to win, if you didn't watch the game on Thursday night and didn't watch the game today, you don't realize how significant this victory is.
Glover, nice crossover move. He's fouled as he goes to the basket. Shamon Williams, that was a shooting foul. It will be the 6th team foul.
And that's what you worry about with the strategy of fouling, is that you're going to get a foul when a guy's in his motion going up. And that's exactly what happened. So with just over 34 seconds left to go, still a two-possession game, five-point advantage for North Carolina. And right now, Deion Glover with the opportunity to cut it down. And once you foul, Mike, you never know what's going to happen. I think the North Carolina State-Clemson game, evidence of that.
Glover has struggled from the free throw line, got the bounce on this one. He shot only 58% from the line. That's ridiculous for a guy who's got as good a touch as he does.
Well, you can see he backs away from the line a little bit when he lets it go. But right now, this is the most important block out of the ball game.
Four-point lead. He missed it. Got his own rebound. And he's fouled again. He knew he missed it the moment he let it go.
And that is exactly what happened in the North Carolina State Clemson game. CeCe Harrison missed a free throw on purpose, got his own rebound, sent the ball game into overtime at Clemson. Ultimately, North Carolina State won. And here you can see the miss and just the massive humanity underneath the basket. And Deion Glover is the guy that comes away with the ball and gets fouled. All of a sudden, the opportunity to make this at least a three-point possession.
If he makes them both, he cuts it to two. Got the first one. Now, he is not allowed, as the free-throw shooter, to enter the lane until the ball hits the rim. Looked like he was a little early. CeCe Harrison was real early.
But that takes a lot on the part of a referee to pay attention to that.
Hits them both, 79-77, with 32.8 seconds to go. Another great comeback by Georgia Tech. Every time they squeeze the door open, North Carolina finds a way to slam it back in their face.
The first thing when a guy is taking a free throw, somebody has to get the shooter. Here it had to be Cota. And you're right, Mike, he was in way too early. Cota wasn't able to get there. The shooter is not allowed to get into the lane until after the ball has hit the rim. Everybody else can go when it leaves the shooter's hand. So Deion Glover was in the lane too early, and the officials just missed it. And that's a difficult one to get.
Boy, Glover has some serious hops, doesn't he?
Well, when you get a running start, you know, he's even more dangerous. He's a guy that's a tremendous athlete. And coming into this program, Bobby Kremins described him very simply as an absolute man. And that's what he showed on that last play.
He's had some men down here before, guys like Dalrymple who came in, who you just knew could wipe up the court with everybody that was out there given the opportunity. Well, Georgia Tech would like to foul someone other than Jamison and Shamon Williams. They'd like to go after Carter or Oak Elijah or Maktar Jai, but they are rarely given the opportunity to do that. You let your good free throw shooters handle the ball.
Exactly, and oftentimes, as the defensive team, you don't get a choice. What your primary goal is to get the steal or perhaps get a five-second call. Barring that, you want to foul right away. And Georgia Tech has the possession arrow in their favor, so if they are able to get a tie-up, that is essentially a turnover.
The shot clock is off. So without a foul, North Carolina could hold it till the end.
And likely, Adamola Okalijah will be the guy who inbounds the ball because he is not their best free throw shooter, so you want to take him out of the mix right away. And also, he's a very good passer, an experienced player, so he knows how to inbound the ball successfully.
32.8 seconds to go. Okalijah got it to Cota. Behind the back, and now Cota will try to kill time. Harkering reached in and hit him. Nobody called the foul.
And how about that? When you're trying to foul, you didn't do it right. And oftentimes, when you're trying to avoid it, they blow the whistle on you.
They'll call it on Glover. Boy, you're absolutely right. Any other point in the game, that's a foul.
Yeah, you know they're going to say in the locker room afterwards, geez, I was trying to foul and I couldn't do it.
Cota, number four in the ACC, is a free throw shooter, 82.4. He makes them both, and he has not scored today. It would be a two-possession game. Nothing but net.
Have you ever seen Ed Cota rattled?
No.
And I can't recall a time when I've seen a pained look on his face or a nervous look. Just always seems in control.
Now Missed the second one. Georgia Tech down by three.
And they don't need a three. You can take the ball to the basket, perhaps get a foul.
Maddox for three. It's tied. Holy cow, what a shot. Now Cota acts like he thinks there's a lot of time left. 7 seconds. Five. Cota missed the shot. Overtime. Holy cow. What a stunning ending to the ball game. Cota acted like he thought there was 30 seconds left to go in the game when it was down to 10.
Here you can see the great shot by Michael Maddox off the Glover pass, and Maddox ready to shoot it when it got there. No doubt about it that he was going to pull the trigger. And you're right, Mike. Cota acted like there was all the time in the world, but really, he got off the shot he wanted. In this situation, you want to get off the last shot. He got it off with about 2-3 seconds left. Didn't allow any time for Georgia Tech to get a shot on the other end.
Michael Maddox with a career high 28 points will go to. Free basketball for you. 80-80 in overtime. 5 minutes on the clock. And now both teams are going back to the huddle. And here's the play that tied it up, Jay.
Deion Glover draws two defenders to him. Oak Elijah was caught in the lane and couldn't recover in enough time. And the fact that Michael Maddox was ready to pull the trigger as the ball was on the way was what made that play. And you and I, Mike, were talking off air about the differing opinions that coaches have when you've got about 25, 30 seconds left and you're down three. Do you take the three? Of course, if it's available, you pull the trigger. But oftentimes what coaches like to do is get something going to the basket, perhaps pick up a foul, get the easy score, and then see if you can get a steal on the inbounds play and foul. But certainly, if you've got an open look as Michael Maddox had, you want to drain it. And Bobby Kremins has to be extraordinarily proud of the effort his team has given today. And this couldn't be, other than losing the ball game in regulation, a worse scenario for North Carolina, as tired and as drained as they've got to be from their last ball game. To come out and see overtime from Georgia Tech, that is not a pleasant sight.
And they have basically played their six-man rotation. Burstiker was in for a heartbeat. Glover. Contact, no whistle, turnover. And Haywood also played a little bit for Carolina, but basically six guys. Bobby Kremins always gives you that look on the sideline. You can tell exactly what he's thinking. In the zone, it's been very effective.
And North Carolina cannot allow this zone to take away their offensive aggressiveness. That's a bad pass.
Carter lost it, saved it somehow. Whoops, stepped on the sideline out to Georgia Tech. So each team starts the overtime period with a turnover. Did you always feel in overtime the first team that got ahead had a huge advantage?
Oh, sure. Once you're up. And that's why you've got to stay aggressive. One of the things that winds up happening in overtime is teams take a lot of time off the clock. They're slower in their offense than they usually are. And it takes away their offensive aggressiveness.
Harpering for three. Huge shot. Matt Harpering puts his club up by three. He has 22.
And he was just battling Vince Carter in the low post and then decided to take him outside. There's a guy whose offensive aggressiveness never wanes.
4 minutes to go in overtime. What a great game it's been, and it's not over. Jamison leans into one, got the bounce. Antoine Jamison with that incredible release.
He just doesn't give the defense a chance. Once he gets the ball, you cannot adjust. You got to keep him from getting it. That's the only defense against Antoine Jamison.
He has 26. Harpering, they're trying to isolate him one-on-one. Maddox for three. Got it! He's having the game of his career. 31 for Maddox. Georgia Tech, hold on to your hats. The Jackets lead by four. We said at the beginning of this telecast, let down, you bet.
Maktar Jai, great pass from Jamison, and Jai with a terrific little left-handed shot. Couldn't ask for much more than this, could you, partner?
What a great afternoon of basketball, and Georgia Tech has really taken it to North Carolina all game long. They just haven't blinked.
Oh, bad pass, another lazy pass. Cota with the pick. Shimon Williams, boy, has he been hot. Goes baseline, caught in there. Throw it away. Spivey with the save, called the timeout. Good play by Spivey. Shimon Williams just went too far underneath.
And that's exactly what Shimon Williams should have done when he got trapped along the baseline. Should have called the timeout right there.
We'll be back in a moment. If you just joined us, shame on you. You have missed a barn burner. 2:44 to go in overtime. Georgia Tech leading North Carolina by two. The Heels soon to be the new number one team in the country. And it might be a short-lived reign as number one. Maddox, 31 points, 8 rebounds. He's hit 5 out of 9 threes. And he has shown no reaction to the pressure whatsoever. He has hit one huge shot after another. It was his three that sent it into overtime.
And in a game of important possessions, this might be the most important possession. If North Carolina can get a stop here, it could energize them a little bit to make a run.
Nearly lost by Clover.
And how would that have been to get a turnover like that after the game we've seen, huh?
Spivey had it knocked away, saves it, picked off by North Carolina, but out of bounds. Cota nearly had it, and 13 seconds on the shot clock. They're saying Cota did not have possession, so the ball went out of bounds. So it does not recycle. So Georgia Tech looked a little tight on this possession.
Oh, they know how important this is. And so important right now to stick with Matt Harpring and know where Michael Maddox is in this zone.
Harpring trying to penetrate. Looked like that ball was kicked. Harpring tries to pick it up. Carter gets it instead and scores. Vince Carter.
Are you kidding me? Beats Harpring down the floor and is able to knock that ball away and still have the athletic ability and the presence to get it up and jam it.
Georgia Tech did not get a shot on that possession. That was partially blocked. Great defense by Carter. And Harpring then commits a foul as he runs into Shimon Williams from behind. What a turnaround here.
North Carolina just seems to make the plays when it has to. We talked about that last possession being so big, and Vince Carter able to knock the ball the other way, just went right off his leg. And look at the hustle here. It's not like Matt Harpring isn't going after the ball. That is called a finish in any league.
Well, Vince Carter is a guy who can finish, and Shimon Williams is someone who can shoot free throws. Rattle that one around and put it in. He's 5 out of 5 from the line.
And all of a sudden, North Carolina has the lead back. And Georgia Tech has to be shaking its head going, wait a second, what happened? We were looking to go two possessions up.
People have been doing that for 30 years against North Carolina. What happened?
Isn't it something, Mike, all the years we've been watching, Georgia and it Texas never ceases to amaze you, you leave the building shaking your head out of what North Carolina can do in these late game situations. Whether Dean Smith is sitting on the bench or it's Bill Guthridge, they seem to answer the bell time after time.
Well, there is a feeling that they come into the building, they think they're gonna win. Unfortunately, the opponents usually think they're gonna win as well.
And what that means is if you're gonna knock them out, you better knock them out. If you're gonna kill the king, get them in one shot.
Harpring for three around the screen, and Georgia Tech regains the lead. Boy, that was a big screen. Was that Jones? That was a huge screen.
I think they gave that a two.
It's a two, tied at 88. Maktar Jai kicks it outside. 1:15 to go, shall I say it, in the first overtime. Knocked away, 2-on-1. Glover trying to take Carter, got by Jamison and scores! Oh, man, what a game.
And it was just a matter of Ed Cota trying to do a little bit too much off of the pass.
19 for Glover. Shamon Williams for three. He finally missed one, and Maddox with a rebound. Shamon Williams had been perfect. It's about an 8-second difference between the shot clock and the game clock. Georgia Tech cannot hold it all the way down. They lead by two. Shot clock at 14. Bobby Cremins jumping up and down, directing traffic.
Want to run it down to five and then get the shot up.
Well, they got to do something. Cremins to Maddox for three. Little strong. Rebounded on the Tar Heels. Here's Shamon Williams. Maddox is back.
Oh, he found him.
But the basket didn't go in. You could see a three-point play coming. Fortunately for Georgia Tech, the ball did not go in, but Maddox commits the foul. And Shamon Williams, he of the deadly free throw shooting stroke, will go to the line to tie it up.
Boy, Phil Ford looked absolutely beside himself after that. What a great pass out by Vince Carter after the rebound. And Shamon Williams, that could have been an absolute disaster for Georgia Tech. Williams goes up, just couldn't finish the play. Look at the reaction. There's Phil Ford on the floor. And he was about as cool a customer as you're going to find as a player, as a coach. He's put through the ringer.
Shamon Williams, if he makes the next one, he can tie it. Now, I think we get that shot of Phil Ford. That's coaching. That's working the sideline.
And you know what? He looked a lot more calm when he saw Shamon Williams on the free throw line. If you've got to have a guy for a couple of money shots, it's Shamon Williams. But you never saw a reaction like that from Phil Ford when he was playing. He was in control all the time. But it's a different story as a coach. You have put all your trust and your faith in the guys on the court. He's got to come through for it.
Historically, let's point this out. At the end of games, when North Carolina misses a free throw, invariably they get the ball. But Shamon Williams makes them both. 6.6 seconds to go. It's up to Harper and gets it to Glover. Looking at each other, no basket.
It will not count. That red light was on, and Mike Wood was right on top of the play.
Oh, man. Floyd missed. Maddox put it in.
The red light at the top of the 30-second clock was on, and Mike Wood was right on top of it. Here's the shot by Floyd. You can see the clock winding down below one, hits the rim, and it was not in the hand of Michael Maddox or out of the hand. A great piece of officiating by Mike Wood. He was the only official that had that call from the outside position. You can barely see the clock from there, but it was clearly the clock had expired before Michael Maddox got that tip.
Just think what a finish that would have been for Maddox to complete the day he has had already. Well, we'll go to the second overtime. We're far from done here in Atlanta. We're tied at 90 as we go to the second overtime. Sometimes the forces that control college basketball giveth and taketh away. This is the kind of game we thought we were going to have the other night, as Antoine Jamison gets two cracks at it and scores. Instead, we get it today, North Carolina, Georgia Tech.
And think about how tired these North Carolina players have to be right now. They're on their way, a couple of them, to playing near 50 minutes in this ballgame.
This is Glover. Boy, one great performance after another by these kids. Harpring squares up. And he'll draw the foul on Carter. Nothing there, and he gets Vince Carter to commit the personal, and the North Carolina coaching staff saying Carter wasn't doing anything but standing straight up.
That's the dreaded plane of verticality. And there Phil Ford again showing he's still got some leaping ability, trying to make the point that our guy was going straight up and down. And that plane of verticality, when you are on your feet, you're supposed to have from the top of your fingertips all the way up to the ceiling. That's your space, and if somebody jumps into you, it's supposed to be an offensive foul.
Doesn't get called very often.
Never gets called. I mean, that plane of verticality is almost mythical.
That's right. Harpring going for his 26th point. We are tied again. Just an incredible ball game.
Here comes the trap, and Cota intelligently goes over the top of it.
4:10 to go in a 92-92 tie.
You know, this game is not going to be won off of a gift. You got to make plays.
Like that. Shamon Williams, finger rolls. He took it right down the gut.
You know, some games where a missed shot decides it or somebody's not able to do something, you're going to have to make a play to win this one.
Career high 32 for Shamon Williams. Harpring gets it into Jones against Jamison, and Jamison commits the foul. We've got four on Antoine Jamison.
Yeah, you don't often see Antoine Jamison outfought for position down low. He just got stuck behind, and here's Shamon Williams on the other end. That's a very quick first step. He knew he could take Michael Maddox off the dribble and then finishes with his left hand. But check out what a great job Jones does, not only getting position on the low block, but when the ball was coming in, he improved that position by getting right into Jamison and forced Jamison to foul him.
6 points, 5 boards. Jones misses the first. Only a 56% free throw shooter. And this is the time in the game where you have to make them.
You also have to block out if you're North Carolina.
Because you know Harpring's going to be coming. Makes the second one. 94-93, heels. All fouls from now on will be two shots.
They've got to get it over.
They beat the 10-second count. Shamon Williams dumps it off. Kicked away, nearly blown opportunity there. Then Williams with a bad shot. Harpering, Jamison just got away with his fifth foul. He hacked Harpering, and no call.
I think Shamon Williams thought he might get fouled when he was taking that shot, but that is not a good enough reason to pull the trigger in a ball game like this when the game's on the line in the second overtime.
Harpering for three, off the mark. Tip by Maddox. Maddox got it back. Harpering got it. Put it in. This is unbelievable.
You know, it's like a championship fight, just blow after blow to the chin. And it's going to be who's left standing.
Shamon Williams with another three.
How about that kid, huh?
They're giving each other their best shot. 35 for Shamon Williams. Remarkable. Glover into the lane. Bad shot.
A great play by Carter to get it on out.
Jamison, jump hook, missed the shot, foul on Maddox.
Now Shamon Williams just game after game continues to hit those clutch shots. And you can look that calm when you got a guy like Shamon Williams who's pulling the trigger on the deep three, and he's been outstanding. And a day when Antoine Jamison has found rough going inside against Alvin Jones and has had a difficult time getting position. And when you know this team is tired, Shamon Williams has been the guy who stepped forward.
And there's just no relief on the bench for him. Jamison will go to the line. He is 6 out of 9 from the free throw line. Hits this one. The lead is back to 3 with 2:25 to go. We are in the second overtime. Mike Patrick, Jay Billis, glad you could join us from the Thriller Dome, aptly named this afternoon. Jamison misses the second. He has 29 points. Floyd is open.
Good
job. As soon as he got the ball, they covered him up.
And a good job by Okaliji to get on Michael Maddox in transition. That was his only goal, was to find Maddox and stick with him.
Floyd to Harpering. Harpering takes it in strong, blocked from behind, and that was Vince Carter. Cota on the run. Great pass to James or to Carter. He's called for a travel, and Carter comes down hard. And grabbed his ankle.
Twisted that left ankle. But it looks like he's going to be all right. I think he got more of a scare than anything else.
He's up and able to walk off under his own steam. That's a great break for Georgia Tech. Here's North Carolina on a 3-on-2 fast break, and they can't convert.
They were trying to go for the knockout blow. Here's Cota bringing it up. They got the lead. You'd think they might want to pull it back out. But Cota tries to go for the spectacular play with Carter. And what made that difficult was Antoine Jamison was on the other end trying to cross underneath. That made a log jam and what caused Vince Carter to go down.
1:54 to go, double overtime. North Carolina by 3. 98-95, North Carolina with the lead in double overtime. How about this for numbers? Shamon Williams, 35 points. He's hit 10 out of 15 shots from the floor, 7 out of 10 threes. He's hit all 8 of his free throws and has 4 assists. That's not bad.
Well, you know what's interesting? You take away his threes, and he's still got 28 points.
Yeah. And Maddox has had his own career day with 31 points. Georgia Tech will need another big bucket here. They have all day as these teams have really slugged it out.
Again, another huge possession for Georgia Tech. You have got to score here.
Harpering, nice touch pass to Glover for three, short. Good rebound. Shamon Williams right there and didn't try to do anything fancy with it.
He had Jamison sprinting out, but intelligently decided to keep it. Burning clock with a three-point lead, far more important than stretching it out a little bit and taking the chance he might turn it over.
Spread the court, trying to take some time off the clock. 120 on the game clock, 14 on the shot clock. Looking to Phil Ford for a little instruction.
1-4 low.
Shamon Williams with a long, long three. Holy cow! 38 points for Shamon Williams.
Mike, that's just ice water.
Oh,
that is just ice water in your veins to pull off. That's a knockout blow.
Glover kicks it off. A three to try to answer. Harpering with a rebound. Goes into the lane. Got it. 101-97. It's more like antifreeze than ice water. I mean, that, how long was that shot?
That had to be about 24 feet.
And you can't blame Glover. Nobody shoots from there. 101-97, double overtime. 101-97 in second overtime. Georgia Tech will have the basketball. Shamon Williams, 38 points, the most since Kenny Smith turned that trick, and his 8 three-pointers ties the school record, last set by Jeff McGinnis.
And look how far out he was. That's beyond the NBA line, and there was no doubt about it. Shamon Williams, what a stellar game, and how often do we have to say it? I guess as often as he keeps making them. This kid hits clutch shots game after game.
Full court pressure. Jones nearly got the steal. Now Georgia Tech trying to foul, and they get to Jamison. Harpering commits the personal. We have him with 4, and they'll send Jamison to the line with 43 and a half seconds to go.
And still plenty of time, even if Antoine Jamison is able to hit both these free throws. It's a 2-possession game.
He has hit 7 out of 11, has 29 points overall.
And this is the hardest time to hit free throws. I'm not just talking about the pressure of a late game situation, but when you add on that fatigue, that's why coaches always have their teams shoot free throws at the end of practice, so they get used to shooting free throws when they're tired for this kind of situation.
5-point lead. Jamison trying to make it 6, and does. Antoine Jamison with a couple of beautiful strokes there. 6-point lead. Georgia Tech needs buckets in a hurry.
Remember, UMass has refused to lose. This is strive to survive.
Glover with a finger roll, got it. 35-3. That's still a 2-possession game, however. They don't want to find Williams and try to make him give up the ball. Glover will be called for the foul with 31-2.
Georgia Tech foul number 5, Deion Glover.
Coming up as soon as we're done, and we may be here most of the afternoon, the World's Strongest Man competition. We wouldn't mind a third overtime. This has been so much fun. But that program will follow us on the deuce, and Shamon Williams, speaking of lethal, goes to the free throw line where he's only 8 for 8. And especially at the end of the game, there are some guys you just know you'd rather have them at the line than somebody else.
And Shamon Williams is one of those guys. And Bill Guthridge, I know, has a lot of trust in Shamon Williams for what he's gone through over his 4 years. Came in, wasn't expected to be that much of a factor as a player. At least that's what all the experts thought, the so-called experts in high school recruiting.
Georgia Tech needs threes now. They're down 6. 2-possession game.
And they're taking an awful lot of time to get them.
Bad pass here. Nearly picked off. Glover has it. Kicks it outside. Floyd for 3. Maddox with a rebound, and he's fouled on the way up. 14.1 seconds. They really did burn a lot of time off the clock.
They did, trying to get a shot up, and Travis Spivey, because he is not as much of a threat to score, allows North Carolina to get out on other people and dare Spivey to hurt you. And obviously Ed Cota didn't want to foul there, but the one thing you do by fouling is take away the opportunity to hit a three.
Maddox with a career high 31 points. He had a tip in just as the first overtime ended that would have won it, but it was after the buzzer. It was his three that kept it alive at the end of regulation. But time is now running out on the Jackets. Maddox tried to miss that one, and he banked it in. When you're hot, even when you try to miss them, they go in.
And isn't that how it goes? Matt Harper tries to foul, they didn't call it. He tries to miss, he couldn't do it.
105-100, and now it's desperation time for Tech. Take any gamble they can take. Get it into Shamon Williams, they'll foul him with 12.6. Shamon Williams can make it a three possession game and put it out of reach.
And what a well-deserved win by North Carolina.
Standing ovation by the Georgia Tech fans as Maddox has fouled out of the ball game with a career day. This is not the Georgia Tech team you may have seen earlier in the season. These guys have gotten better and better, and when it comes tournament time, people are not going to want to play these guys.
And they will be in the NCAA tournament. Their record is going to fall to 3-7 in conference, but that does not indicate how well they have played in conference play. It's not even close.
They'll be 14-9 overall. North Carolina, the new number one team in the country, come tonight when the polls are released, will go to 24-1. It's 107-100. And the only thing in doubt right now is the final score. Two seconds to go. Vines at the buzzer, no good. A valiant effort by Georgia Tech, but Bobby Crimmins and company come up short to Bill Guthridge, who coaches his team to its 24th win of the year. Once again, our final score, North Carolina 107, Georgia Tech 100. Coming up next, the World's Strongest Man competition. For Jay Billis and our entire ESPN crew, this is Mike Patrick. Good night from Atlanta. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports.